The show is strictly for educational purposes. The opinions expressed on the show are personal to the individuals appearing in the show and not those of Thinking Tree Ecoholics Private Limited. The show is not intended to offend or defame any individual, entity, caste, community, race or religion, or to denigrate any institution, person, living or dead. Listener discretion is strongly advised.
Hello and welcome to Ecoholics Thinking Tree series. Today we have with us very distinguished personality, Dr. Govind Rao. He was the member of 14th Finance Commission. He was also the member of Economic Advisory Council to Prime Minister. He was also the director of NIPFP. Welcome, sir. Welcome to our show.
Thank you.
Today, we'll discuss about an insight into the concept and the structure of fiscal federalism in India. Because he was the member of 14th Finance Commission, so none other person or personality can explain better than him. Be it a federal government, a union government, a democracy, or a monarchy, finances have always been a matter of debate among them. In India, the 14th Finance Commission took the historic decision of increasing the tax devolution to the states by a massive 10%. Today, we have with us one of the people responsible for this step to tell us how it all worked in favor of India. So to begin with, do you think that the recommendations of 14th Finance Commission have somewhat succeeded in achieving cooperative federalism in India?
Let me at the outset say that you did in your introduction mention that the 14th Finance Commission did a massive increase of 10 percentage points
yes.
in the tax devolution. Well, in terms of numbers, you are right. There is a 10 percentage point increase in the tax devolution. But if you really look at it very carefully, this is not really the case.
Okay.
Now, what has really happened is that, when the Finance Commission was deliberating, the terms of reference of the Finance Commission did not make a distinction between non-plan and plan.
Yes.
The previous commissions gave only non-planned, expenditure requirements of the states. So we had to take it on the plan side. That means that we had to actually give the grants which the Planning Commission was giving earlier, and that had to be a part of our recommendation.
Yes.
That was somewhere about 6% of the divisible pool. So from 32, it became 38.
Yes.
And then the commission decided that it will not make any discretionary grants other than the revenue deficit grants and national calamity relief and local body grants. The previous commissions had given a lot of money for forest and education, healthcare, and a variety of discretionary grants they had given. And this commission decided that it will not. In fact, the 13th Finance Commission went on to give some 100 crores for a medical college in Haryana, 50 crores for a governor's house in Tripura, 150 crores for lake rejuvenation in Karnataka, 150 crores sea erosion in Tamil Nadu, and so on and so forth. Several grants they had given. We completely, we desisted from doing this type of discretionary grants. Yes. So the money saved that on that account was almost something like 1.5% of the discretionary pool. So the distinction is between 39.5% and 42% and not really 32 to 42%. This is something which I had several times I had to say. Then the question comes, why did you increase from 32%, even if this thing there is a marginal increase, why did you do that? So what we did was, we looked at the expenditure pattern of the states and the center. And if you really look at it from 2002 to 2012,
yes.
If one looked at the expenditure pattern, the central government or the union government spending on the state subjects in the constitution had increased from 14% to 20%. Now, union government spending on concurrent subjects had increased from 13% to 17%. Why should you not let the state government to spend on their subjects as decided in the constitution? Why should the union government come and spend it?
Yes.
So the point is, union government should focus itself on the union subjects rather than trying to influence the voters in the state subjects. You know, it's easy for the union government to come and make spending through centrally sponsored schemes, because this is where it can, you can go to the electorate and say that, look, I am spending on you, it is not your state government spending on you. You know, basically, it's a sort of a vote-catching sort of strategy. So we thought that the state governments have to legitimately spend more on the state subjects, and therefore we should give greater flexibility.
Yes.
I mean, even when you have the centrally sponsored schemes, it come via grants. Yes. But then they don't have flexibility. They, you know, it is not an untied grant. So yes. And therefore, we increased it by 2.5 percentage points. So it's not really that we have made a massive increase. So in some ways, I think this was an act of rebalancing. You know, we did this act of rebalancing.
Yes.
Of course, the central government has always complained that, you see, we have gone well beyond what they wanted us to do.
Yes.
But then the Finance Commission is an independent body, it is supposed to do. However, you should also realize that you know this Finance Commission is only one of the instruments. Finance Commission giving you transfer. The total amount of money, the decision on the total amount of money to be given to the states is decided by the government, central government itself.
Yes.
And that has not changed. In fact, you know, if you look at it, something like the 60% of the state central revenues are generally, tax revenues generally go to the states. That is, you know, for both the Finance Commission's transfers and other transfers. So that has not changed. What happened immediately was, immediately after the recommendations were made, you know, the untied transfer to the states increased. Flexibility to the states increased to that extent. But then the central government was not satisfied with that. You know, that, see, the recommendation, the implementation of the recommendation coincided with the sharp reduction in the petroleum prices.
Yes.
The international price of crude. What the central government did is to levy additional excise duties on it. And any discretionary changes that they made is through cesses and surcharges. So to a considerable extent, and these are not shareable with the states. And to a considerable extent, what the Finance Commission did through increased tax devolution, they undid through increasing taxes which only go to the center. And as a subsequent period, even the centrally sponsored scheme, they had a committee which basically made a recommendation. You know, they appointed a committee to rationalize the centrally sponsored schemes. And that committee, you know, there were about 66 schemes. They reduced it to 29 umbrella schemes. Yes. And then classified the schemes into you know, sort of core of the core and optional. And increase the state share in the schemes. Earlier, for example, Sarva Shiksha Abhiyan, the center used to pay 75% and the state used to pay 25%. Now most of the things have been reduced to 60-40.
Indeed.
Okay? Now in other words, they increase the share of the states. So our attempt at rebalancing and giving a larger share of larger proportion of untied transfers could be a considerable extent, you know, done away with, you know, sort of nullified through some of these measures. But nevertheless, I think the states were happy, and I thought there was a lot of hue and cry at the time, you know, many of the people saying that, oh, now, you know, centrally sponsored schemes on education, healthcare, and all that will vanish. And, you know, then obviously the money, the state will not make adequate allocation to, you know, social sector. Mm-hmm. And that was not found to be true. States continue to make substantial allocation to the social sector. It's another thing that what allocation is made is not enough because they don't have the money. You know, that's a different issue. But basically, it is not that the Finance Commission did something very unusual. I mean, we did only a marginal increase, but to a considerable extent, that has been nullified by the actions of the state. So, in other words, you see, you need much more robust institutional mechanism for spirit. Fiscal federalism, you know, cannot be done by one institution called the Finance Commission.
Seriously, indeed. Because, sir, it's a zero-sum game. If you increase the share of the states, obviously the center share already come down. So that's a great, great point, sir. It gave more clarity. Since you were mentioning about the share of the grant, for most of the government schemes, we observe that the fund sharing is in the ratio of 60-40 for the plain states and 90-10 for the Himalayan and northeastern states. It is in fact that the hilly states find it difficult to raise funds given their topography. However, don't you feel there must be more focus on capacity building in these states to bring them at par with the rest of India rather than providing constant financial support even after 70 years?
Well, I think issue is a little more complicated than that.
Yes.
You know, until the time there was no partition in the country, that belonged to the mainstream.
Yes.
And once, you know, you had the East Pakistan carved out and the entire northeastern region got cut off.
Yes.
The only way to northeast is something like 25 kilometer, this thing called the Chicken Neck.
Yes.
You know, through Siliguri area.
Yes.
Now, that is, so you complete loss of connectivity. No, you'll be very surprised that northeastern states, in particularly Assam, had a per capita income higher than the national average. And now it is only about 60-70% of the national average. Now, over the years, connectivity has been a major problem. There, and when you have the connectivity as a major problem, both physical and social infrastructure has not been developed. And then obviously these are all tribal areas, and there is a whole lot of insurgency that has come up in these areas.
Yes.
So issue is not very simply one of actually capacity building there. The issue is one of governance, issue is one of, as I said, connectivity, the infrastructure, the whole lot of things that are associated with that. Now, in fact, I was the director of NAPAP, the Ministry of Northeastern, Northeastern region requested us to do a vision document for the Northeastern region. And I actually led a team of scholars to do this study. And we came up with a very detailed vision document, which was signed by all the chief ministers and governors and adopted, but nothing has been done thereafter.
Yes.
Because there is a lot of infrastructure thing that needs to be done. But at the same time, there are some bright spots. Today, if you look at it, you know, the Sikkim has the second highest per capita income in the country after Goa. Now, the things are happening in some places. Not in all places, but things are happening. If you look at the revenue collection, the GST collections there are reasonably high. You know, it's not as high as in the plains, but then it's certainly much better than what they used to collect.
Yes.
As we go further, I think, once you start giving crutches, it will continue to be crutches. That is one of the reasons why, you know, the 14th Finance Commission, when it made an assessment, we did not make an assessment saying that this is for general category states and this is for the special category states. The money from the center goes to the states for enabling the states to provide comparable levels of public services at comparable tax rate.
Yes.
You know, if you are talking about the comparable levels of public services at comparable tax rates, you should offset their revenue disability. You should offset their cost disability. In other words, their tax base is low. If they levy the tax at the same rate, the per capita tax collection will be low. Mm-hmm. So you need to really offset this. Now, that is the basic purpose of general purpose transfer.
Yes.
And so we made a similar assessment like others. You know, we did not do this thing. But obviously, this special categorization has been an act of the National Development Council and the Planning Commission, and that has continued. But then I think either you need to give them more money or you should spend more money in building a proper infrastructure. And you should help them, handhold them to ensure that, you know, sort of, in fact, you see that the Nagaland, you know, insurgency issue has continued forever.
Yes.
So you need to put these things down. There has to be a clarity. You know, the basic function of the government is to enforce property rights.
Seriously.
Basic function of the government is to ensure, you know, to protect the life and property of the people and enforce property rights. Now, if, unless and until that is done, your investment will not take place. So investment can take place unless, you know, you need to really do that. And once you do that, then you don't have to give, you know, you see, the failure is as much on the part of the center as it is on the part of the state, because, you know, at the end of the day, these are all states with international borders. These are the states where there is a huge amount of insurgency, and then we have not yet settled these as a part of accession to the country. I mean, who is supposed to do all this? Once you do that, I think the things will be much better. But the basic, until then, you know, these crutches will continue. And however much I talk about it or you talk about it, the problem will continue until these basic conditions for development are satisfied.
Seriously, it means the problem is more of political, not of economical.
Well, it is both political and economic. As I said, it's a much more complicated, you know, this thing. It's political, it is social, it is economic. You see, when the Northeasterns come here, you discriminate against them. You know, I mean, there's a whole lot of things that happen.
Yeah, there are cases for the national capital.
I mean, they need to feel that they belong to the country.
Seriously, yes.
You know, I mean, the point is, if they don't feel that they don't belong to the country, and then you tell them that you don't belong to the country, the things don't work.
Seriously, indeed. So apart from tourism, what are the areas, if we make a checklist, what are the areas that Northeastern state can empower themselves to?
You know, there are two ways of developing a state. One is either you take capital.
Yes.
Or you take the people out of people and take them to the capital. I mean, if you have seen, there are two things that have happened. There are a large number of these states have a tremendous potential for floriculture. They have, you know, horticulture. You know, possibly some of the best kiwi fruits growing in the country come from Arunachal Pradesh.
Yes.
Okay. Now, you know, I mean, you want to get the kiwis from Australia, New Zealand, but then there are some of the best kiwi fruits come from there.
Yeah.
And in fact, some of the states, because with the better connectivity, are actually exporting a large number of exotic varieties of flowers. So you have, I mean, for example, Sikkim has a completely natural way of, you know, cultivation. You don't have, you know, sort of organic way of cultivation that has gone up. So there are lots of things, you know, in fact, some of these large cardamoms, the most expensive large cardamoms, most of it is grown in Sikkim.
Yes.
You know, I mean, so there is a lot of potential there, but then they need connectivity. Many of these items are perishable and they need connectivity, and then obviously they can, you know, have a quick transportation. Okay. You know, Sikkim, you know, got its airport, you know, just a couple of years ago. I mean, you don't even have an airport. Mizoram had its airports only a few years ago. No, I mean, you know, Aizawl, for example. So, perishables perish. You do need to really have that. So, in other words, there's a lot of investment that you need to do in infrastructure. There's a lot of investment that you need to do in terms of, you know, settling the entire this insurgency issue. And once that happens, because you see, transportation becomes much more in areas where there is insurgency. So once that happens, the things can do much better.
Since the 14th Finance Commission had mandated prudent levels of both fiscal deficit, that is 3% of GSDP, and debt to GDP for the state is 25%. That must not be breached by the states. When we consider the data from the states, except for the fiscal year 2016-17, the state government have regularly met their fiscal deficit target of 3% of GDP. This is a matter of concern because most states ended up meeting the fiscal deficit target not by increasing their revenues but by reducing their expenditure and increasingly borrowing from the market. What are your thoughts on it, sir?
Well, this question requires multiple answers, but let me start by saying the following. Number one, you know, sort of your interpretation that 3% of GDP and 25% of GDP as fiscal deficit target is broadly true, not entirely true.
Yes.
Because the Finance Commission went a little bit. You see, its recommendations are very nuanced. It went a little ahead and said that if a particular state has its debt to GDP ratio less than 25% and its interest payment to revenue less than 10% in the previous year, it can get additional borrowing space of 25 basis points. That means states can go up to 3.5% of GSDP if its debt to GSDP ratio is less than 25% and its interest payment to revenue ratio is less than 10%. Okay, now, so that means some flexibility was given to the states there. So I want to keep the matters, clear.
Yes.
It's not just 3%. Some states which had a better borrowing capacity were given more borrowing space.
Yes.
And then what happens is that obviously any target that you give, any summary measure that you give as a target, obviously the focus will be on target.
Yes.
If you say that you should have a revenue like this and an expenditure like this, you put multiple targets, then obviously they will have to look for multiple targets. Now you can reduce the deficit either by, it's not that they really have much of a choice. What really happens is that the central government, they have to seek the permission of the center to borrow.
Center to borrow, yes.
The constitution gives them allows them to borrow, but if they are indebted to the center, they have to seek the permission of the center to borrow. The center will not allow them to borrow more than 3% of GSDP. So obviously they are, it's a sort of a hard budget constraint.
Yes.
When you have that, so they have the flexibility either to raise revenue. But what revenue can be raised, particularly after the GST was ceded to the GST Council?
Mm.
You don't really have much of a taxes. The only major taxes they have, so-called major within inverted commas, taxes they have is excise duty on alcohol,
yeah.
Sale value-added tax on petroleum products, motor vehicles tax, taxes on stamps and registration duties on property transfers.
Mm, that's it.
These are the only thing. Mm. And obviously there are limits beyond which they can raise. The administration matters a little. GST is entire administration, virtually the entire thing is taken away from them, impact maneuverability. So obviously they don't really have, and then what happens? The central government goes up and increases the price of petroleum products and then leaves very little scope for these people to raise taxes.
Raise taxes, yes.
No, because it raises additional excise duty. Even now, the crude oil prices have fallen. The central government has gone ahead and then increased the additional excise duty.
Yes.
And this additional excise duty, when you increase that, is not shareable with the states. So they don't really have have that much. In other words, you curtail the taxing space. So
yes,
they don't really have much of a taxing space. So what do? They don't have much of a thing where they can sell and then, disinvest and do that. I mean, of course, some of the states are now thinking because of the COVID problem. That's a different issue. But so obviously, the only thing is expenditure. Here again, what happens is that the productive expenditure get the axe. Capital expenditure are the ones easy to cut because the committed expenditures on wages and salaries, and and then of course interest payments, pensions, etc., cannot be done. You can't do anything. So there has been a problem. But that problem is, it is natural to, now the issue therefore is, you can also ask this the question. In fact, if you look at the FRBM review committee, which looked at the, N.K. Singh committee, which looked at the thing, they said that the target, for the fiscal responsibility, this thing target is the debt to GDP ratio.
Yes.
And in order to reduce the debt to GDP ratio, they said the anchoring variable is deficit to GDP ratio. So, that comes from there. And in fact, you see, earlier in the FRBM Act, you had a target on revenue deficit also.
Yes.
But now they don't have the revenue deficit target. So, ultimately, if the objective is to raise the debt to GDP ratio, and fiscal deficit is the anchor, you know, your objective in whether to increase revenue or cut down the expenditure, you know, sort of that doesn't get into the entire scheme of things.
Yes.
So obviously, it's a question of making allocation from the scarce resources that you have, and that's all that one can do. And the states have tried to do their best. At least they have contained their fiscal deficit within 3%. Though there are some exceptions.
Yes.
Because, for example, you know, because of the poor performance, the electricity distribution sector, they had to take over the loans, and then obviously the interest payment had to be paid on that. The deficit are exceeding the 3% level that yes. That was set, but by and large, you know, they have maintained that they had to maintain that, and then they don't really have much of a way to raise revenue, and they have to cut down expenditures.
Sir, as per the constitutional provision, that is highly elastic revenues are, so revenue sources are under the jurisdiction of union or the central government, like foreign aid, deficit financing. As a result, with the passage of time, states in India have become more and more dependent on the center for financial help. What are your views on this, as you were mentioned earlier also? So how you can raise the extra sources of revenue for the states? It means, is the government, union government, should allow the states to borrow from foreign funds or take amount of loans from the developmental banks? Like,
you see, the founding fathers of the constitution had thought of the issue in a very, very systematic manner. In the literature on fiscal federalism, you come very clearly, which shows that, you know, there are three major functions of the government: macroeconomic stabilization, yes, redistribution of incomes, and allocation of resources between the public and private sectors and among various services within the public sector.
Yes.
Now, macroeconomic stabilization is predominantly a central function. Yes. I didn't say exclusively, predominantly a central function. Now, which basically implies that the center has a major responsibility to see that volatility in prices is contained, employment is increased, and then, you know, macroeconomic variables are set in motion for a faster growth, etc., etc. So the predominant responsibility is that. And if you allow the states to go and borrow,
yes,
from anywhere and everywhere, then there is no control over the overall, you know, overall debt situation in the country, which is a very crucial variable to determine the macroeconomic stability.
Yes.
And then, you know, again, you know, deficit financing, you said, you know, these are not revenues. Mm-hmm. Deficit financing is a source of financing. It is not, yes, revenue means you have to earn. This is an, yes, unearned, there is no earning here.
Yes.
And so the point is, so elastic sources of revenue are income tax. That is the only major elastic source of revenue.
Okay.
Here, so obviously, when you are saying that, you know, deficit financing, you know, even the center, you know, in fact, there is always this case: when the markets fail, the governments have to come and then intervene.
Yes.
What do you do when the governments fail? You know, we had a massive deficit financing that was done before. And we got into a major, you know, sort of balance of payment crisis in 1991. And thereafterwards, there has been a lot of thinking on this. And then, of course, the Fiscal Responsibility Budget Management Act came in 2003 to tell the central government that you also should control your deficit. It is not that you can go ahead. But before that, you know, before 91, there never used to be a terminology in our discourse called fiscal deficit.
Seriously.
This, you know, they used to say budget deficit.
Budget deficit, yes.
And the budget deficit is not fiscal deficit. Budget deficit is, you see, you borrow from the market, and whatever is uncovered by the borrowing market is actually borrowing directly from the Reserve Bank of India by issuing short-term, you know, treasury bills,
yes.
And it was automatic. So there was automatic monetization of the deficit that went on. And that went on. And that is one of the reasons why, you know, whatever is not covered, you know, I have an ambitious plan of spending. And so the Reserve Bank will print money. And then you did not look at the consequences in terms of inflation.
Seriously.
And then what happened was that in 1990, Now, this discussion went on. You know, we can't be letting it happen. In 1997, there was an agreement between the then governor of the Reserve Bank of India, who was Rangarajan, and then Ministry of Finance Secretary, and that was Montika Ahluwalia. There was an agreement that in future, we will not do automatic monetization of the deficit. We will get rid of this entire business of treasury bills, issuing treasury bills and automatic monetization.
Yes.
And so from 1998 onwards, you don't have automatic monetization. Yes. So even the deficit financing can't be done. You know, the point that I'm trying to make is, even the center cannot do deficit financing as it wants.
Yes.
And, you know, in the earlier, it can borrow from the market. But if you borrow from the market, the yield goes up. And if the yield goes up, you have to pay a much higher rate of interest.
Yes.
So there have been certain amount of checks and balances that have been put in place.
Yes.
But at the same time, and of course, 2003, there was the Fiscal Responsibility Act, which basically said that you've got to really control your deficit. Government of India has been flouting. And possibly the solution to that is another institution. In fact, in many of the countries, they have what is called fiscal council.
Oh,
okay, now, for example, in the United States, you have what is called the Congressional Budget Office.
Yes.
In many other countries, you have what is called the Parliamentary Budgetary Offices. In UK, you have what is called Office of Budget and Accountability. These are created by the Parliament to provide a check against the government's decision to go on really, you know, sort of, you know, doing the deficits, you know, incurring deficit, and then monitoring them. You know, control and audit then comes after the event is over.
No,
but this is on the concurrently. They start with evaluating your budget forecast, saying whether your budget forecasts are right or wrong. And when some governments comes up with the major schemes and then makes announcement of the schemes, nobody actually budgets these schemes. This Parliamentary Budget Office actually estimates what would be the expenditure involved in actually carrying out these schemes. Mm. You know, you said Namami Gange, it has gone on and a lot of money has been put in the drain. And we don't know what is the total amount that is really required to clean up the Ganges and what are the various things. But we have been spending taxpayers' money on these. And then the third thing is monitoring the fiscal deficit of the government and saying that, look, you can't do this.
Yes.
So that has not happened. And in fact, there is a recommendation in the 14th Finance Commission, basically asking the government to move the parliament to appoint a fiscal council.
Fiscal council, yes.
Okay. Now, I mean, these are all institutions of, you know, the basic question that I asked. Yes. When the market fails, the governments intervene. When the governments fail, what do you do?
You need
to have the institutions to create checks and balances in the system. Yes. And that is precisely what you know, we had said. But in any case, as I said, you know, it is not that the government of India has all the things. And the state governments have to really manage within whatever is available. And that is the reason why you have an independent institution called the Finance Commission, which comes every 5 years and then basically examines the finances of the center as well as the states and sees what is the reasonable amount of money that can be transferred to the state. And one, to the credit of successive governments in India, one of the major things about the Finance Commission is that it has been respected, its mandate has been taken, and then its recommendations have been accepted.
Yes,
indeed. For the most part. I mean, by and large. There have been one or two exceptions, but by and large, the basic recommendations and the transfers have been accepted.
Yes. I think after the change in the organization of Planning Commission to Niti Aayog, the relevance of Finance Commission has come up. And that's a great, because we have a constitutional body. And that's
not really the case. I'll tell you, it is not the relevance of the commission has come up. Actually, it resurrected the revolution. You see, if you go back and look at the history, when the third finance commission came into picture, that finance commission was not asked to look at only the non-plan side. I mean, it was asked to look at the totality.
Yes.
But by that time, the planning commission has become a reality, though it is not a constitutional body. It's a, you know,
extra.
It was created by a cabinet resolution.
Yes.
Now, but then what happened is that the government asked the member secretary, the serving officer of the government, member secretary, to write a note of dissent The main recommendation was that yes, planning commission exists now. We will give, we will assess the entire thing. For plan side, we will give something like, you know, sort of, we will give 75%, we will take into account, 25% recommendation, you know, sort of grant they can give. The planning commission can give. This was the main recommendation. But the note of deficit is that you should completely desist from looking at the plan side at all together, allow the planning commission to do. And when that happened, when that is the only time in the history of this country that the finance commission recommendation was rejected. And the note of dissent of the member secretary was taken. And subsequently, for all the finance commissions, the term of reference basically said you look at only the non-plan expenditure requirements. Until the 14th commission, where somebody forgot to put that word non-plan. You know, so the basic point that I'm trying to, so now, so, you know, in fact, you see the idea about looking at, you know, sort of not looking at the idea about looking the entire thing holistically came even before the planning commission came into picture. Planning commission was abolished because the terms of reference was given much before the planning commission was abolished. Yeah. And it's a different thing that the planning commission is abolished. So, in other words, the constitution envisaged the finance commission to be the only body to make the transfers. Yes. But then the other things have developed. Discretionary transfers came in, but then with the abolition of the planning commission, at least the general purpose transfers, you know, came to be the entire prerogative of the finance commission.
Since you were talking about the old finance commission or previous finance commission, if you see the number of people in the state is a determinant of amount of resources required by the state. However, the weightage of the population has been steadily decreasing in the recommendation of subsequent finance commission, and it is evident from the latest finance commission report as well. How has this helped in the better resource allocation?
You know, in order to know that, you need to know what is the purpose of transfer. Why do you want? What is the objective of making transfers from the center to the states? Yeah. As I said, in the according to the received wisdom and the theory. There are states with the high tax base, there are states with low tax base. Yes. There are states where the cost of providing public services is high, then the states where cost of providing services is low. In a situation like that, if you say that the objective of the transfer is to enable the states to provide comparable levels of services at comparable tax rates,
yes,
then what you really have to do, population is only a neutral fraction, it is a scale factor. Yes. What you really have to do is to provide for revenue disabilities and cost disabilities. If you are providing for revenue disabilities, that means that the state's per capita, low tax base it has, its per capita tax collection at the same rate of tax is low. You know, Bihar, for example, you say 10% tax in Bihar will get very little per capita tax as compared to 10% tax in Haryana.
Yes.
Now, so the public service quality and quantity of public services provided in Haryana will be much higher than that of Bihar if you don't have a transfer. So if you say that you need to equalize, that means comparable levels of public services if you want to give, then obviously the revenue disability of Bihar has to be taken into account. So basic objective of the transfer system is to offset the revenue disabilities and cost disabilities. And if that is the case, over the period, successive finance commissions have been trying to get proxies.
Yes.
So, you know, you say the distance from the highest per capita income multiplied by population is basically, multiplied by population is a scale factor. But yes, distance from highest per capita income that you take, or the inverse of per capita income that you take, is, yes, to take out the revenue disability. The state with the lower revenues have to be given more.
More, yes.
So this is the type of, so that is how, see, you take forest cover. You know, obviously the cost disability is higher in from where there is forest, you can't raise revenue.
Yes, seriously.
So, or for that matter, density of, or the, for that matter, area of a state.
Yes.
Larger the state, obviously the cost of providing public services would be higher. So most of the factors that you take into account in the tax devolution formula represent predominantly revenue disability and cost disability factors, and some weighted, and all these are weighted with population.
Yes.
Now, it is not that the population, the explicit weight is given, but in addition, each one of these factors is weighted with population.
Population, yes.
So there is the implicit weight of population is still substantial, but that is the way it is. That is the way it is done.
Okay. So thank you so much for coming on to our show, sir. At last, a few words of encouragement for Ecoholics.
Well, I mean, I think you are doing a wonderful job, the Ecoholics thinking tree. I think, you know, these are some of the issues which are basically, they're far too technical for people to understand in one go. And, you know, you are doing a great things by, you know, putting these things out so that, you know, one gets an informed understanding of, you know, various complicated issues in policy. And that's extremely important for, you know, for the people at large, for the policymakers as well. Even I have seen most of the policymakers don't know the technicalities of things. And some of us who have nothing better to do, you know, go on reading and writing on the same subject and become so-called specialists. And when you become, and it is always nice to share these so that general understanding and, you know, of the subject goes up, general thinking of the subject goes up, you will be able to appreciate the entire thing much better, you know, in the sense that, you know, when a particular policy is put out, you will be able to appreciate it better if you know what exactly is the logic behind the entire scheme of things. And so in that sense of the term, I think Ecoholics Thinking Tree is doing a wonderful job, and you should keep it up.
Thank you so much, sir. And thank you, Dr. Rao, to coming on our show. And it was a very insightful discussion, very eye-opening session, because what we read in the newspaper is very different what you have explained. So it's like more clarity on the thought, especially on the center-state relation, fiscal federalism. Thank you so much, sir, coming to our show. And it was wonderful. Have a nice day.
Thank you.